Good evening, everybody. A very, very warm welcome. Today, my backdrop is different. I'm in a different city. I'm in Hyderabad and I'm not at home. So obviously, I don't have all my colorful things. But what I have for you is Pan, his mom, and these beautiful, colorful little puppets, right? So as we always do, I'll do a small little snippet before we start. So Pan was out one day. He saw two puppets on the way. They were wearing clothes so bright. No, they were wearing clothes so bright. The turban man was playing an instrument with one string. Oh, and you should have seen how the colorful woman would sing. So it was a beautiful instrument on a string and the lady who could beautifully sing. Everyone was just dancing along and there was just rhythm and happy songs. His mommy said that, do you know that there are stories that these wonderful artists, folk artists can sing. It's generations of talent that these folk artists bring. So Pan looked at his mom and said, really? Do they not read and write? How are they then so bright? So Pan's mama said, no, they do read and write, but the stories are sung and people learn how to sing and they sing it along and they teach it to their children and they teach it to their children and their children. And that is how the generations sing a song. So that's the folk and the beautiful culture of this lovely, lovely country. And to talk about stories, to talk about rhythm. And the one thing that caught my attention when I saw Nitisha Ji's profile was the fact that she loves folk tools and she's a storyteller. So Nitisha, a very, very warm welcome. And we're so happy to have you on our show.
Thank you, ma'am. It is a really nice experience, in fact, Ms. Sonia, to attend this particular session. And it was a very nice story indeed. So, yeah.
Thank you. Nitisha, one thing that I have been noticing in the last many years, if you noticed, I had these beautiful puppets from Rajasthan. And I realized how little of this is used in our classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
And that is how I started exploring folk art, folk music, folk, traditions. Maybe not the exact folk story, because that, in the learning environment can become a little sensitive. But how beautifully we can integrate it. So for me, my association with storytelling, of course, is old, but rhythms and folk was from about 4 or 5 years in Rajasthan. Where did yours start from? How did this journey begin?
I think it's from childhood itself. Okay. So we belong to Madhya Pradesh and interiors of it, Indore. And as we say, our grandmothers, right, Nani and Dadi. So they had these beautiful folklores and the stories and folklores itself. And we kept hearing all these. And the way you were saying in the rhythm, right? The same way they used to say us all the different kind of stories, maybe Ramayana, Mahabharata as well, even others. And it was a beautiful experience. So when you were showing those puppets, I remembered or recalled my grandmother's, It was
they say chan. Chan is rhythmic words that come one after the other. Mm-hmm. And that whole wonder is just not used in our schools enough. Mm-hmm. I also want you to just tell the audience a little bit about what you do and even your journey as the teacher, a coordinator, the head, and what you do now. So then they can understand the relevance of how you're connecting it to schools and learning.
See, I happen to teach different grades of students. So when I was teaching grade 9 and 10, student experience was different. Then from teaching grade 9 and 10, I happened to teach grade 1 as well. That was a challenge for me. Teaching grade 9 and 10 mathematics, you're teaching grade 1. Now, how will you modulate your voice? And how will you create that enthusiasm in students and make them work? right? So then I worked a little bit on how I'm speaking to my students, what I can do so that they get attracted or give me their attention, right? So one thing I found out was voice modulation and stories. So the moment you say that, you know, today I have a story for you, everyone wants to listen. Everyone is like, you know, wide open with their eyes and they really want to listen to what I'm saying. And through stories, when you start your session, they really love to do whatever you say because they already have learned a lesson from that story, right? So, and in the stories, again, I have different varieties. So my story starts with a background. Then there is a problem. Oh my God, right? So that oh my God factor is really attractive for the students. They all want to really hear what is that oh my God factor, right? And right after that, how the people in the story or the characters in the story, they deal with the problem. Yeah, this is basically the whole process of storytelling is very interesting. And students, they really hook on to the lessons when we inculcate storytelling with your usual lessons. I happen to have storytelling in my ICT class as well. I used to have ICT dance. So the kids were used to love ICT dance.
So what would that entail? I know you can't get up and dance for us, but you just explain that to us and maybe you can just...
Oh, it was a wonderful experience. So I just had to teach them input output devices, right? And there can be some devices which are neither input nor output, right? And there can be devices which are both as well, right? So we just developed a dance. So if it is an input device, you will clap. If it is an output device, you will jump, and it's online teaching, right? So they happen to jump, clap, and in a way they learn, okay, keyboard is an input device. Printer is an output device. Then I came to neither input nor output device. So they have to do this way, right? And if it is both input and output device, you just have to do this, right? So this way. And they really loved it. Now, after we did these kind of dances, maybe twice or thrice, they learned what are the input output device. They don't forget.
They associate it with an action.
With a folk action. Maybe, tell me.
I have never heard of this, truly speaking. I would have never thought of it. You know, I would have just never thought of this. You know, that you can actually do, like a rhythmic movement for something like this, which can associate and stay with the child and the mind. So, you know, when this is also for the audience who are watching us. So when Nitisha and me were having this little chat, she came up with this story. And so what I'm going to ask her to do is to do both the forms of the story. Of course, we will not be using the complete form of the traditional folk, the story. Two reasons why we change it is because in the academic environment, you have to be very sensitive. So I'm going to request you, Nitisha, that you do the story for us in the new one, in the new version. And then we will tell them the old version. I'm sure many of them would already know the old version, but let's see if we can do the new version.
There are many stories which I keep telling to my kids. I do book reading as well, but this particular story is very dear to my heart because this is what I heard when I was a child, and I kept hearing from my mom whenever she tells story to anyone who comes to my house, maybe a kid, maybe my friend's daughter, maybe my own kids, right? So anyone who comes, she tells only this particular story. So she's very fond of telling this particular story only. And I love this one. So here it goes. I don't think it's listed anywhere or it's written anywhere.
Oh, it doesn't matter. We would, because that's what folk is all about. It's from your nani to you, and it will be from you to your children. Exactly. And that's the whole way that the entire, they don't have anything written, you know, to find really written manuscripts is next to impossible. But generation to generation, these stories go on. So we are going to see the new changed version of it from you.
Sure. So it is the story is all about their students and teachers here. We have a nice story about little mouse. All right. So it's in Hindi. Ek chota sa baby chuha tha. Wo ja raha tha ek sadak ke upar. Wo ja raha tha aur usko jaate jaate ek choti si chindi mili. You understand chindi? Chota sa kapda. Theek hai? अभी छोटा सा कपड़ा उसको मिला उसने सोचा इस कपड़े का क्या करूं, what should I do with this cloth? Now what he did, he went to other people, he asked them, what should I do with this? No one could say, इतने छोटे कपड़े का क्या करोगे, nothing. Then he thought for one or two days and then he thought, okay, इसकी टोपी बनाता हूं मैं. ठीक है, अब उसको टोपी सिलना तो आती नहीं थी, वो गया दर्जी के पास, बोला दर्जी दादा मेरी टोपी सी दो. दर्जी दादा ने बोला पैसे हैं? तो चूहे ने बोला नहीं है. दर्जी दादा ने बोला भाग भाग. चूहा ने बोला मैं घर को तक लेके आऊंगा, पैसे चुकाऊंगा, टोपी से लाऊंगा. ओके, तो दर्जी दादा ने बोला लाओ लाओ दो, मैं अभी सिल देता हूँ तुम्हारी टोपी. उन्हें फटाफट से टोपी सिल दी और दे दी उन्हें. बड़ा खुश हुआ वो, जा रहा था सड़क पे, फिर से अच्छी सी टोपी सिली पहन के मजे से जा रहा था. फिर उसको रियलाइज हुआ, उसने सोचा अरे ये टोपी तो बड़ी गंदी सी दिख रही है, सिल तो गई है, टोपी तो है, दिख तो टोपी रही है बट गंदी सी दिख रही है, क्या इसको मैं रंगवा सकता हूँ? वो गया रंगरेज के पास. किसके पास? रंगरेज के पास. रंगरेज को बोला रंगरेज दादा मेरी टोपी सी दो. रंगरेज दादा ने बोला पैसे हैं? चूहा बोला नहीं है. रंगरेज दादा बोला भाग भाग. तो चूहा ने क्या बोला, मैं घर को जाऊंगा, गुल्लक लेके आऊंगा, पैसे चुकाऊंगा
और अपनी टोपी को रंगवाऊंगा.
एग्जैक्टली राइट. तो रंगरेज दादा बड़े खुश हुए, बड़ा अच्छा चूहा है, उसने पैसे बचा के रखे हैं इस दिन के लिए. उन्हें फटाफट से उसकी टोपी रंग दी और उसे दे दी. वो घर को गया, गुल्लक लेके आया, पैसे चुकाए और टोपी ले गया. फिर वो जा रहा था, उसने सोचा ये टोपी बड़ी सुंदर दिख रही है, बड़ी प्यारी सी दिख रही है, पर कुछ तो कमी है इसमें, क्या किया जाए क्या किया जाए. फिर उसने सोचा क्या मैं इसको सजा सकता हूँ, गोटा किनारी लगा सकता हूँ. वो गया गोटा किनारी वाले के पास, बोला गोटा किनारी वाले दादा प्लीज मेरी टोपी में गोटा किनारी लगा दो. तो उन्होंने कहा पैसे हैं? चूहा बोला नहीं है. उन्होंने कहा भाग भाग. तो फिर चूहे ने क्या बोला, बोलिए बाप,
मैं घर को जाऊंगा, गुल्लक लेकर आऊंगा, पैसे चुकाऊंगा, गोटा किनारी अपनी टोपी पे लगवाऊंगा.
वेरी गुड वेरी गुड, यू गॉट इट राइट, वेरी नाइस. देखो अब आपको आ गया. फिर गोटा किनारी वाले दादा ने क्या बोला, लाओ लाओ टोपी दो, मैं अभी गोटा किनारी लगा देता हूँ. और उसकी गुल्लक को देख के वो बड़े खुश हुए, उन्हें प्यारी सी लच्छी लगा दी अपनी तरफ से. बड़ा खुश हुआ चूहा, टोपी पहन के जा रहा था रास्ते में, जाते 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 उसे ढोलक मिला. बड़ा बदमाश चूहा था, बड़ा बदमाश, सबको छेड़ता था. अभी गया तो उसने लिया ढोलक और गाने लगा, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम, राजा से मेरी टोपी अच्छी, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम, राजा के पास नहीं ऐसी लच्छी, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम. राजा बड़ा गुस्सा हुआ, उसने ली उसकी टोपी, छीन ली. चूहे को बड़ा बुरा लगा, पर चूहा तो था बदमाश, छोटा चूहा था, बड़ा बदमाश था. चूहा बोला राजा जी कंजूस, मेरी टोपी ले ली, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम, राजा जी कंजूस, मेरी टोपी ले ली, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम. ठीक है, राजा को लगा कि कंजूस तो मैं नहीं हूं, इतना बड़ा राजा हूं, क्या मैं इस छोटे से चूहे की टोपी ले लूंगा? तो उन्हें टोपी दे दी. चूहा बड़ा भयंकर बदमाश था. आगे आप सुनेंगे उसने क्या बोला. बोला राजा जी डर गए, मेरी टोपी दे दी, डम डमा डम डम, डम डमा डम डम. राजा जी बड़े परेशान हुए कि मैं कुछ भी करूं ये बच्चा मुझे परेशान ही करेगा. राजा जी डर गए मतलब क्या, राजा जी डरेंगे? उन्होंने कहा इससे हमें नहीं लड़ना है, चलो आगे बढ़ो. उनने अपना कारवा आगे बढ़ाया और चूहा डम डमा डम डम करके अपने घर पहुंच गया. तो कैसी लगी स्टोरी?
ब्यूटीफुल. तो हमने इसमें प्रोफेशन सीखे, हमें इसमें सीखा कि यू नो आप, एंड आई वांट यू टू आल्सो डू द ओरिजिनल वर्जन. मैं इसलिए आपको ओरिजिनल का एक सेंटेंस बोलना बोलूंगी. क्योंकि मेनी टीचर्स टेल अस दिस दैट यू नो द स्टोरीज आर नॉट द काइंड वी कैन यूज इन द क्लासरूम. सो आई वॉन्ट देम टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट वी कैन पिक अप द रिदम एंड द एसेंस ऑफ द स्टोरी and just like you modified it, you know, you changed it to make it suitable for a classroom environment, you can bring in the rhythm, the music, the simplicity with those little changes. So the change was the sentence, of course, when he met this day. So we would like you to just, this is all right, because it's all adults watching, we're not having the children don't really say. So the sentence to it is ki,
what happens, Miss Sonia, is when we hear stories from Nani and Dadi, it is fine whatever they are telling us, right? मतलब कभी कभी fun element के लिए अगर वो हमें कुछ भी words बोल रहे हैं वो चलता है. But as a teacher, when I am talking to my children, या मैं अगर कुछ story अपने बच्चों को सुना रही हूँ, so I cannot use any kind of word anywhere. तो उसमें जो चूहा है वो ये बोलता है, चार सिपाही लाऊंगा, मार पिटाऊंगा, फिर टोपी लेके जाऊंगा. तो दैट वी हैव चेंज टू घर को जाऊंगा, गुल्लक लेके आऊंगा, पैसे चुकाऊंगा, टोपी लेके जाऊंगा, बिकॉज वी कैन नॉट शो कि हम लोग दादागिरी कर रहे हैं और मार पीट कर रहे हैं. दैट
सो दैट इज व्हाट आई सेड दैट यू नो द डील इज टू पिक अप अ कांसेप्ट, टू पिक इट अप फ्रॉम नॉर्मल यू नो डिफरेंट वेज ऑफ डूइंग स्टोरीज एंड इट इज अबाउट हाउ यू मॉडिफाई दैट. So because Nitisha has done a story and I can't really call myself a storyteller, Nitisha, I am, but I do write for children, and today I normally don't tell them my own stories, but I will today. So I'm going to use a kartal. Okay. I don't play it as well as the artists played, of course. So I will. So this is a beautiful story about how normally when you say Danav or you say people don't, you know, take it very well and they say, oh my God, how are the children going to take it and all that. So I'm going to actually do a little story I do in my course, and it's on visualization. A lot of folk art is depends on your ability to visualize, because there is nothing else. There is rhythm, there is language. And there is no other tool, there is no picture, there is nothing. So you have to imagine it. So this is also something which you call, I mean, it is a concept that I came across by one of these artists saying that isko hum, you know, jaise hum ek diwar hai, darwaza hai, uske samne bachcho ko bitha dete hain, lekin wo bahut kuch nahi hota. So it's like a diwar to hai, darwaza aap bol rahe ho samne dekho ek darwaza hai, aur ye Dantapur ka darwaza hai. So the child is sitting in front of you, or the children are sitting in front of you, and the artists are only telling you a song. So I modified it into something like this. I thought, let me also sing one song today. I have not sung a new thing. So just a small clip of a thing, you know. So Dantapur mein Danav aaya, Dantapur mein Danav aaya, bachon ko dekh ke khub muskaya, khub muskaya, khub muskaya. एक दुकान पे गया. This was a story we did for the अक्षर के लिए हमने ये कहानी लिखी. ठीक है. wow. तो खूब खूब मुस्काया, खूब मुस्काया, और दुकान पे गया. उसने टॉफी का डब्बा देखा, कहा मुझको सारी टॉफी है खानी. सब बच्चों ने कहा दांत खराब हो जाएंगे, दवाई लेने दुकान पे पड़ेगा आना. ऐसे नहीं है टॉफी ले जाना था. दानव तो दानव था, दानव तो दानव था, कहां बात मानता. खोल खोल के टॉफी खाई, खोल खोल के टॉफी खाई, सुबह सुबह आवाज आई, सुबह सुबह आवाज आई. दान दुख गया भाई. दादाजी फिर वहां पे आए, दातून अपने साथ बुलाए. दादाजी फिर वहां पे आए, दातून अपने साथ बुलाए, और दानव राजा को दान साफ करना सिखाया. कैसे सिखाया. ऊपर नीचे गोल गोल, ऊपर नीचे गोल गोल, कुल्ला करने के लिए नल बस थोड़ा सा खोल. अब दानव कैसे दान साफ करता है, सब लोग करके बताएंगे. ऊपर नीचे गोल गोल, ऊपर नीचे, अब तेज तेज करना है आपने. ऊपर नीचे गोल गोल, ऊपर नीचे गोल गोल, और नल और कुल्ला करने के लिए नल बस थोड़ा सा खोल. तो हमारे पास ना दानव था, ना पिक्चर थी, ना दुकान थी, ना टॉफी थी, ना डब्बा था, ना दातून था. बट आप इमेजिन कर पा रहे थे कि नहीं.
बहुत अच्छे से, बहुत ही अच्छे से.
That's the power of simplicity. where you have nothing except rhythms and you are allowing the child to imagine, to think, and you're using words which are very, very not acceptable in the system. Mm-hmm. But these words can be used in such a way that, so, you know, this is the biggest fear people feel about, you know, the folk tools. That's why I told you, please do the story with modification. And that is why I use my Danav story, because that's another word which everybody says, oh, no, 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 you can't teach this to children. But my children, when they used to learn it, like I have it in one of my books, they're so happy because they just, every time, you know, people would say, Danav aa raha hai, bade daant hai. And instead of that, now it is this big Danav with bade daant who knows how to clean his teeth beautifully. So we modified it and used a concept into teaching children. And I think that's one big, it's an important part of this folk coming into the classroom. You know, to take away the fear. So I want you to just tell the audience what you do, Nitisha, for your you know, what's your profession? What do you do? That's one thing I want you to talk to the audience about.
Sure. I am, by heart, I'm a teacher. And right now, I'm doing coordinatorship. I'm founder of Abha Chaitanya Welfare Society as well. So we do different activities in this NGO. There are other activities which I'm also interested. I take book reading sessions. I do story writing sessions for small kids. Small kids as in maybe grade one kids, pre-primary kids. I just call them in my community at my home, a free session of book reading, a free session, you know, on just writing a story of their own. Or maybe they have a, like, you know, very small, we will make a small chit kind of a book. We'll take a A4 size paper, just fold, cut them, and we make a small book and we write story. And we are very happy because so many kids and so many stories we can finish in just 30, 40 minutes. They all love it as well. So these are other things apart from my regular work.
So what is your regular work right now?
Regular work is I'm working as a coordinator. That's all. So, managing teachers.
So also what Nitisha is also doing is she's heading, international curriculums as well. And yet she feels that this kind of language, this kind of rhythm can get integrated. Do you feel that?
Definitely. So basically all the folklores, no matter which country it belongs to, if you inculcate in your sessions, that's what we call as UI, Unit of Inquiry, and transdisciplinary approach in international schools. So we have all these kind of rhythms, maybe from different countries, different cultures, different civilizations. We take the essence of those and we try to, have a transdisciplinary approach in our classrooms with sciences, with math, with ICT. We have these kind of maybe dances, art, or music.
So it is like a very important part of the NEP, which they're talking about the integration with absolute simplicity, with whatever region you belong to, you pick in that art and put it into the curriculums, make it a part of the daily, learning for the child. And I think what, Nitisha is talking about today is also going to encourage a lot of people to think about this. That if you can do this with an implementation of an international curriculum. And I loved what you said about folk in all parts of the world having a similar essence. Mm-hmm. So there is a beautiful festival in Rajasthan, in Jodhpur, called the RIF. It's the Rajasthan International Folk Festival. Mm-hmm. So I was really lucky to attend it for the last couple of years. It's a beautiful festival, which brings folk artists from all over the world.
Okay.
And they integrate their music and rhythm and instruments with the Rajasthani folk artists and the other folk parts of India. Beautiful. It is an amazing journey to see. And I think that was one whole awakening that I had when I said that, oh my God, the rhythms are the same, you know. It is just that the instruments would be slightly different. So unfortunately today I'm not at a place where all my instruments are with me, but I have this little damru kind of a thing from Varanasi, and I have one beat from Africa. Mm-hmm. They sound the same.
Oh wow.
You know, only the structure of the material, the tool is a little different, but the sound is so much the same. And I slowly am also telling schools to start integrating simple musical instruments into the classroom. What do you feel about that?
Yeah, we have generally all international schools, if you see, they introduce these small instruments right from pre-primary. So when I ask my teacher, like music teacher, what are you going to teach in pre-primary? They start with these small drums only. And they have their own like shaking instruments.
The tambourines, the percussion instruments.
Yes, yes. They have those small ones. And they say that with this, we'll have some music, some rhythm. And let us, introduce music right from pre-primary. They have. But yes, when it comes to folk instruments, like ektara, all these instruments, still we have yet to go. You know, we have not introduced yet.
Yeah, but I think it's another thing, because we're talking about this ektara or because these things require a skill which is very different. Mm-hmm. Do you feel at any point of time it's a good time for schools to start inviting the local folk artists to come and be a part of this school? Do you feel it's a good thing to do?
Yes, folk artists, folk dancers, folk music. And, you know, with that, when you listen to folklores, with that, you would come to know a lot about that particular culture, that particular place, because all the stories give you a lot of essence of that particular place, the way the things are carried out in that civilization. And it really mingles well with history, with literature. And we are very much interested in those fields and not only studying English as a subject. So we deep dive into the research, and it's a very good idea to, invite all the schools, tell all the schools that this is the right time where we can invite the folk artists in our schools and we can have a presentation from them. So it is, even they should get an exposure and teach our children.
So one very important thing will happen if we do that as a responsible community, is that the folk is dying because they don't have people to adopt them. See, earlier the Raja, the king used to be the judgman, used to be the king, used to adopt the folk artists and take care of the families, the food, the clothing, the shelter, etc. Today, that kingliness is not there, right? The royalty is, not really. So this is a time where the local population, schools take over the role of nurturing this community. Otherwise, after some years, we are not going to have them left. They will all leave the folk art and they will start going into other professions.
Definitely.
And then, like what Nitisha said, we will lose generations of music. We will lose generations of folklore. We will just lose it. So it's time we all wake up and say that this is a conscious effort each school is going to make, and imagine what we will do to this whole community of artists. I think that's a beautiful point you made, that it brings in generations. Yes, Nitisha.
Just to bring a very good point over here, maybe not as a school, but as a community. So where I live is Prestige Shanti Niketan, Bangalore. It's a huge community with 3,000 flats. And we have over there this Ganesh festival. So right now, Ganesh Festival is going on. So just wanted to bring this. So every year, around 11 states, so ladies from different states, they participate. It's a huge festival over there. So every group basically has maybe 11 to 20 ladies. And we represent our own state and we do folk dances, folk music. We also display our artifacts of our own state. So that's how, as a community, we realize this and we do display the folklore folk artists as well. We don't want it to fade away. So as responsible citizens, we try to, do over there as well. So I do participate in a lot of folk dances and I represent state Madhya Pradesh over there. And we have done Matki once. We have done Baredi. Baredi is again a folk dance. From Bundelkhand. So such folk dances, which are of interior parts of Madhya Pradesh, I have done on a national level platform because it comes in news as well. So it was really good experience.
Oh, lovely is that.
Others get to know about our tradition and we get to know their tradition as well.
So now that you're telling me this, suddenly I'm just recollecting this, that Asiad 82, right, 82, that the opening ceremony of Asiad in 82 was the folk dances of every state. And I remember I had represented the Banjara community from Andhra Pradesh.
Wow.
I mean, I'm just recollecting that, you know, because they picked us up, they picked up students, and then they picked up the community, the proper Banjara community women. And we had all come and stayed in Delhi, and we had performed the Asiad opening ceremony. And it was the most beautiful experience of my life. Imagine you're just... I so many years and I haven't related this actually. My God, I have to take out my Banjara dress now at some point. I still have it.
Really good. You yourself, see, as a person, I was not knowing about my own state and the folk dance. But because I wanted to take it up, Madhya Pradesh never participated for 5 long years. So past 2 years, fine, it was Corona. But before that, for 2 years only, we participated. Otherwise, it was this tradition of other states participating was going on from 7 long years. Then I researched myself what all kind of folk dances we have in Madhya Pradesh. Then I got into, okay, Matki, I knew, okay, we do it. But Bareri is something which was very different. Then I researched on it. Because they want to write up proper announcements and everything. But then this, you know, this way, at least we ourselves come to know from where we belong, what are the traditions, and why this dance is done, what was the reason, what was the festival, right? So I think, as you're saying, folk dances, this brings up a lot of history element for that particular civilization, that particular area, right?
Yeah, but then the story, food, the flavor, the dresses, the costumes. So I think even the foundation in early years, rather than just teaching children, you know, that this is the festival of lights or this is the festival. So we could actually start integrating a few movements, rhythms and dances teachers can explore and actually let it come alive. Even on an online, if you have children who belong to a community, maybe they can do a little, you know, the parents can help them out. But this is something which is very doable. So I also realized one thing when I'm talking to you, you know, sometimes when you're not very like Nitisha, I don't make my list of questions for my the speakers. Because sometimes what you say generates the next question.
Yeah.
You know?
It's a nice conversation.
It is about, today my cup of tea is not there with me. Otherwise, I seriously sit with my cup of tea and I just talk to. So another thing that I, in my conversation with you is that if we are conscious and if we research, we can bring it into our classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
We can bring it into the community around us.
Yes.
And we can stop feeling awkward about it. You can step out of your home dressed in a nice, traditional, happy environment. You can call artists. You know, we are all becoming so based on just music from the internet. Why cannot we actually start? And, you know, unless we are going to get music into the ears, which is the music which we want to save, we don't expect the children to be attuned to it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So I think this is one great, great, you know, lesson which all of us are going to carry back. Before we wind up, a little bit of the book reading that you said you would do with us, if you don't mind doing it.
Sure. Any book? Is it okay if I read an English book?
Yes, please, yeah. Please. Because we did a story in Hindi. Let's do the book reading in English. And also, this is for everybody watching. Book reading can be done in any mother tongue as well. It is just that we are using English and Hindi because that's the most commonly understood language. Otherwise, it's beautiful if you can find your own mother tongue stories and read to your children.
Yeah, before starting this book reading, I just want to bring this particular idea over here that I myself was not good at book reading. So when I was a child, I just wondered how people just sit with a book and they read a book for a long time. I liked it, but I could never do it myself. So when I had my first child, I made sure that he loves book. And I think now he is 7 years, almost 6.5 years, and he must have read more than 1,000 books. I have read more than 500 books for him, and each book, you know, he makes sure that I read at least 60, 70 times for him. So it's like only book reading at my home, and hardly games and all, because he loves book reading. It has just come up in our culture at home. So now the scenario is every day, maybe, you know, 3 hours at night, you just want to read books, 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock. I know it's very, you know, awkward timing, but then if we all sleep also, he will sit with his emergency light and he will read books. Now, how it started is because I started a lot of bedtime stories with him, a lot of bedtime book reading with him. So I'm just telling you a nice bedtime book reading. This is about Alex, a cute little bear, and what he did wrong at home. And, you know, how he approaches mom and how mom consoles. So it's like, I'll always love you. The mama says, I'll always love you. Whatever you do, I'll always love you, right? It starts that way. So it is illustrated by Penny, and it is written by Mr. Lewis. The book name is I'll Always Love You. So one morning, Alex woke up, and he woke up early, and he ran downstairs to the kitchen. He just thought in his mind, what should I do? I'll make mom some toast and honey for the breakfast, he said. She'll like that. Alex reached for the honey bowl and, oh God, just think what is going to happen. He just reached for the honey bowl, top. No, I cannot tell what happened. Crash! His mom's favorite bowl was now into 9 pieces. He never wanted to break it. What if his mom sees it? Oh God, she was unaware. Alex's mom was doing her morning exercises. And Alex reaches there. Hello, Alex, she said. Did I hear something break? Mom, will you only love me if I'm good? Asked Alex. I'll always love you, said his mom. And she smiled. Even when I've done something that isn't good? Asked Alex. I'll always love you. I'll still love you, said his mom. Honest. Pakka.
So it's also really important sometimes to have the right pauses to let the children get curious. Yeah, Nitya, go on, please. Please go on.
Now, this kid asks, what if I have a pillow fight with Joy Bear and all the feather burst out? Will you still love me? I'll always love you, though you must pick up all the feathers. Okay. What if I spill my new paints on baby Paul and she turns green, red, and blue? Will you still love me? I'll always love you, though you have to give her a nice bath. What if I forgot to close the fridge door and baby Paul pulls everything out? Will you still love me? I'll always love you, though there won't be any food further. For the dinner. What if I pour Grandma's bears? What if I pour Grandma Bear's lumpy oatmeal all over my head? Will you still love me? I'll always love you, though you will have to eat another bowl of meal. Now, why are you being such a silly bear this morning? For a few moments, Alex didn't say anything. Then he whispered, what if I break your favorite honey bowl? Will you still love me? You know, I'll always love you, said his mom. Now come on, Alex. It must be lunchtime. It must be breakfast time, right? Let's go down. And off they went into the kitchen. God, what will happen now? Let's see. Alex is tensed. Oh no, cried his mom when she saw the 9 pieces of sticky china. This was my favorite bowl, Alex. Oh God, she's so upset now. Sorry, said Alex. 2 tears ran down his face. You said you will still love me. I love you, Mom. Of course I love you, said Alex's mom, hugging him. Hey, I've got an idea. Wait, shouted Alex, wriggling from her arms. What is it? She asked. It's a surprise, Alex said, and he ran off his bedroom. He looked in his toy box, he looked in his closet, he looked in his table, and at last he found what he wanted. He got out his new paints, poured some water into the jelly jar, and swirled his paintbrush around. Can you guess what is he doing? Yes, that's a surprise. A little while later, Alex came downstairs again. Here you are, Mom, he said, but be careful. The paint is still wet. I'll be very careful, said his mom, smiling, because this is going to be my new favorite honey bowl. Yes, he painted a new honey bowl and he gifted it to his mom. Nice idea, isn't it? Yes? Yeah, beautiful. So that's how it goes.
So I think also because you were reading on the screen, the one thing that I found in between is while you were reading on the screen, you paused. But I actually like these pauses a lot because it also teaches children to be a little patient. Even if you're reading a book, dear parents and teachers, it's okay to pause a bit. It's perfectly all right. You know, of course, our pauses were for a different reason, but it's good to pause. It's good to have these expressions. And sometimes with book reading, it's good to shut the book and not complete it so that you pick it up the next day, right? So yeah, this was beautiful. Nitisha, thank you so much. You're a mute too. Yes. So it's been a lovely journey today. We've done different kinds of things. I think that's what is making this whole community building with the Square Panda so beautiful, that we are seeing so many kinds of skills, so many kinds of people doing beautiful work, inspiring us. Thank you so much for being here with us. Thank you.
In fact, it was a nice session. And the only thing I liked about this particular session is even I learned from you how to use, folk instruments. You use kartal and how to have a story. It was so nice when you were doing slowly in starting and how you did it very, very fast later. So I just remember that particular poem that the kids have in their childhood, Roly Poly, up, 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 Roly Poly. Yeah, so it becomes very fast towards the end. So like that, you know, when you're brushing teeth, you're going slow initially and then you do it fast. It was really nice.
Thank you so much. I'm very, very honored that you were here with us. And we hope that you'll come back to our platform some point of time in the during the year.
Thank you. Thank you. Definitely.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Sejal. Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Square, square, panda.